My name is Connie Arzigian, and I'm an archaeologist with the Mississippi Valley Archaeology Center at the University of Wisconsin-La Crosse. I want to talk to you today about one of MVAC's most significant projects. This was the study of the Sand Lake Archaeological District, which lies northeast of the city of Onalaska, just north of La Crosse in southwestern Wisconsin. It lies on the eastern margin of the Mississippi River Terrace system at the mouth of a side valley, which is called a coulee in this region. The site is part of what archaeologists call the Oneota culture, representing the first substantial indigenous agricultural populations in this region that starts in this area about 1300 AD. On this map, you can see dots for the many Oneota sites that are known from the La Crosse area, with Sand Lake here at the margin of the large terrace systems and a side coulee, Sand Lake Coulee. The people living in these areas lived in larger villages on the big Mississippi terraces. They fished in the Mississippi River, hunted in the surrounding valleys and uplands, and collected wild plant foods such as wild rice, nuts, and berries. But they also had farm fields, and Sand Lake is the best studied of these fields. This large Oneota site complex was recorded first in 1980 after volunteers with the La Crosse Area Archaeological Society and students from the University of Wisconsin-La Crosse found pottery and stone tools on the surfaces of modern plowed fields. MVAC and UWL conducted initial excavations there in 1982, 1984, and 1986, funded in part by research money from the National Science Foundation and with volunteers through the Earthwatch program. The excavations revealed tens of acres of perfectly preserved, ridged agricultural fields with surrounding habitation areas. The project grew national attention and even made it to the cover of American Antiquity, the national journal of the Society for American Archaeology. More importantly, the project led to a better understanding of the complex and sophisticated agricultural practices of these first agriculturalists of the region. Like many other small tributary channels near La Crosse, the mouth of Sand Lake Coulee had been blocked by sediment at the end of the Pleistocene. That's about 10,000 years ago. There was a release of glacial meltwater further north that led to catastrophic flooding in this region and led to sediments being dumped to block off some of these side channels. This trapped a small floodplain that in later areas, this is from 1847, still had a pond. This trapped floodplain had soils that were moister and more fertile than the surrounding sandy terraces where the people often had their villages. So from the late AD 1400s into the early 1500s, Oneota inhabitants took advantage of these soil conditions and they built and maintained an elaborate system of ridged fields. Here you can see some of the fields that were exposed during excavation. Particularly in this lower picture where you can see some people excavating, you get a sense of the size of these ridges. They're almost a meter across in some places, and you can see that they will have shallow cornfields even on top of the ridges. You can see, we're going to talk later about how you can see multiple layers of ridges, in fact, being exposed here. We think that the ridges were not all aligned in the same way, though. We did a series of excavations across many parts of a large field, and in each one of the trenches plotted the direction that the ridges were running. We used that to reconstruct this series of theoretical directions and plots of these ridges. And it looks like these might be running in separate areas, perhaps to define separate family plots or something like that. This also would have had the effect of not allowing continuous erosion to go across in any one direction because there would not be large patterns of flow that would be able to extend over the whole field. So if there was erosion or there was water moving through here, it would not cause serious problems in these bottom areas. But there was some erosion. And you can see this is a Google Earth image from today. And you can see there are still areas, these hillsides are covered with trees. And the people would have been harvesting these trees to build their villages, to build their houses, to use as firewood and so forth. And at some point, these must have become deforested and perhaps started to erode. And this would have led to sediment washing down the hill slopes and starting to bury the deposits that were at the foots of these hills. So what happened is some of these ridges, this is an original ridge, and it was buried by some of this lighter colored soil that was eroding off of the hilltop. So they built the ridges again. You can see these darker bands coming in, these second darker bands, and it eroded again. And they built the new ridges again on top of these. In some places, this process went down almost 10 different episodes. You can see here a drawing for one of these series of different ridges that were built up and that were buried and were built up again. Eventually, the alluvial soil that was washing off the hillside did bury these areas, forming a large alluvial fan. And the people left this area and probably moved into other areas that had not yet been buried by such sediments. So we don't really know how these fields were being used, but we suspect that they were being used similar to the way that indigenous populations at contact and into the present were growing what they call the three sisters, corn, beans, and squash. So here's some experimental garden that we did where we tried out with our bison scapula hoe in growing the three sisters. And what we think they would do is plant the corn seeds in the top of the hills, put the beans around the corn plants, plant them a couple of weeks after the corn so that the corn would have sprouted. The beans, as they're growing, would grow up the corn stalks using the corn as supports. They would plant the squashes along the base of the ridges, and the big leaves of the squashes would spread out, cover the soil, smother weeds that were coming up, and prevent a lot of evaporation to keep the soil moist. The beans would also serve to fix nitrogen in the soil, so this would help to maintain the fertility of this process. So it would have been a very successful agricultural system. What kinds of tools were they using for this? Well, we were using a replica of a bison scapula hoe, the shoulder blade of a bison that could have some portions of it trimmed off and made into a hoe and then hafted. And here you can see a collection of them that have been prepared and buried, but they had never come back to use them. So we think these are important tools for the people to use as their agricultural tools for the area. How were they storing all this food? Because they were harvesting a lot of different corn, beans, and squash. This is what they would have been using to live over the winter and to use as the seed for the next year. How were they storing it? We think they were storing it based on this model from Buffalo Bird Woman's Garden. This is a woman who was, her indigenous knowledge, her traditional practices were recorded by an anthropologist, Gilbert Wilson, and she drew this model of a storage pit. It is very similar, we think, to the ones that we would have had here in the La Crosse area. The outer part would have been lined with grasses or reeds to keep the crops from actually contacting the soil. And then there would have been the corn cobs, were often braided together and put around the outside. And then shelled corn and beans would have been in the middle. Within the very center part of it, sliced squashes that have been dried would have been put in the middle where it was the driest. And then this would have been covered with some skins and some grasses and earth to protect it, to keep animals out, to keep it from over the winter, to keep it protected. We've done experiments with these and they work very successfully. They would have been successful ways to store crops over the winter. The corn would have been fresh the next spring, ready for both eating and for planting in the next year's gardens. So what did they do with all the pits? Once they had taken out the corn and the beans, they would have been left with these holes in the middle of their villages. And these holes are these features of what we excavate hundreds of, and they're often filled with the village garbage. So here's one of these pits that we excavated, probably had been first dug to be used as a storage pit, but then it was used to fill in with the village refuse. So you can see some of these layers here are just the ash from a fireplace that have been cleaned out and thrown into the pit. So we've got these kinds of garbage pits all across our Oneota sites that mark the storage facilities associated with what might have been the crops from all of these rich field systems. And it was an important part of the Oneota adaptation in this area, the Native Americans growing the 1400 AD. For more information about this, do check out the Mississippi Valley Archaeology Center's website. We have more information about the archaeology of this region, about Indigenous farming practices, and there's also information on how to contact us if you find something in Western Wisconsin, you want to share it with us, or you want to find out more information about it. Thank you for watching.